could contain the amount of water necessary for its survival. And I haven't even mentioned the rate at which this water would have to soar through its veins to provide oxygen to its cells. Thus, there is no possibility for an organism which has hemoglobin to have evolved it. Therefore, hemoglobin must have been present from the start. George Wald, recipient of the Nobel Prize in Physiology, stated, quote, "I took a little trouble to find whether a single amino acid change in hemoglobin mutation is known that does not affect seriously the function of that hemoglobin. One is hard put to find such an instance." End quote. The improbable Ward refers to has been raised to the 120th power to produce just one protein. Hemoglobin is ingeniously designed so that iron attracts oxygen to your blood. This is the opposite of the interaction between iron and oxygen in the environment, which causes a destructive effect. How could evolution learn to change the destructive effect into a necessity? Clearly, the complexity and interdependence of life discredits evolutionism. There is nothing in science which makes the idea of evolution of multicellular organisms possible, much less provides evidence of it at all. All that has been learned in biology points to design and creation, every single thing. Question number 6. Living things look like they were designed, so how do evolutionists know that they were not designed? Richard Dawkins wrote, quote, "Biology is a study of complicated things that have the appearance of having been designed with a purpose," end quote. Francis Crick, the co-discoverer of the double helix structure of DNA, wrote, quote, "Biologists must constantly keep in mind that what they are seeing was not designed but rather evolved," end quote. The problem for evolutionists is that life shows too much design. Who object when archaeologists says that pottery points to a human designer? Yet if someone attributes the design of living things to a designer, that is not acceptable. Why should science be restricted to naturalistic causes rather than logical ones? To which I add, geneticist Michael Denton stated, "To fully grasp the reality of life, Michael Eigner, professor of neurosurgery and pediatrics at State University in New York, Sunnybrook, an award-winning brain surgeon, named as one of New York's best doctors by New York Magazine, is quoted, Darwinism is a trivial idea that has been elevated to the status of scientific theory that governs modern biology," end quote. No one would argue that an automobile is not designed. And yet a cell is vastly more complex and interdependent than an automobile. So why is it rational to believe that life was not designed? If we enter into a factory with hundreds of machines and people performing numerous processes to produce a product, we automatically know that what we are seeing is a product of intelligent design. Likewise, if we could enlarge a cell to the size of a city block and were able to enter it and observe the processes going on inside of it, there is not one person who would come away from that experience knowing that the amazing things going on inside of it were not designed. Was not a product of random chance and self-assembly. And yet, the most complex of man's factories could be said to be infinitely less complex than the functions occurring within a cell. All persons who had such an experience would instinctively know that what they observed was automated machinery that was so complex and interdependent that it could only have been designed by someone of astonishing genius. Why then is it rational to believe that life is a product of random chance? What is it about biological life that can be interpreted as a product of the ability of molecules to bond with each other? The idea that the human eye evolved is absurdity. Retina cells are astonishingly complex. To simulate 10 seconds of the complete processing of a single cell of the human retina would require the simultaneous 500 nonlinear differential equations 100 times, and that would take several minutes of processing time on a Cray supercomputer. How could random genetic mutations design such an apparatus? In the so-called Cambrian strata of the Earth, are various species of trilobites and many other species with eyes, the greatest variety of eyes found in the earth. In fact, the now extinct trilobites had the most complex eyes of any creature known to have ever existed on the earth. The Cambrian strata possess all body plans and virtually all phylum of life that still exist, which demonstrates that Darwinian phylogenic tree of life is upside down, since we see stupefying complexity and diversification in the lowest strata instead of an increasing complexity and diversification moving upward in the strata, as the Darwinian evolutionists should have us believe, if evolution were true. The origin of ears, likewise, and all other structures of organisms demonstrate intelligent design. Prior to the 1990s, synapsids were considered true reptiles, but evolutionists reclassified non-mammalian synapsids into what were called early mammals. This reclassification is based upon the presumption of evolution and a need to demonstrate their theory. Evolutionists based their claim on transition from reptile to mammalian ear bones upon two things. One, that the imagined development of the first and second arch mesenchyme into ear bones, and the rebirth of Haeckel's ideas of phylogenetics. But these mesenchyme of mammalian embryos develop into the middle ear bones, but in reptiles they become the lower jaw. Ernst Haeckel made this a similar claim over 100 years ago and was discredited and shamed for it. So why is this concept still being promoted by evolutionists? In fact, evolutionary biology professor of Brown University, Dr. Miller, has promoted this very same idea in his book on biology, his university textbook, where he has rehashed Ernst Haeckel's old ideas by using photographs of human embryos instead of fallacious drawings, still promoting the false idea that the similar structures in the neck of a fish or a chicken become a similar feature in human beings, which they do not. Question number 7. How did multicellular life originate? How did cells adapt to individual survival, learn to cooperate and specialize, including undergoing programmed cell death to create complex plants and animals, to which I add. In his paper Scant Search for the Maker, A Review of the Triumph of Evolution and Failure of Creationism by Niles Eldridge, University of Bristol bacteriologist Alan H. Hutton states, but through 150 years of science of bacteriology, there is no evidence that one species of bacteria has changed into another. Since there is no evidence for species change between the simplest forms of unicellular life, it is not surprising that there is no evidence for evolution of prokaryotic to eukaryotic cells, let alone throughout the whole array of higher multicellular organisms, end quote. The most absurd claim, as of recent, by evolutionists regarding this imagined evolution of multicellular organisms is that green algae can be observed to band together. This, however, does not constitute a multicellular organism. It is instead a gathering of single-celled algae into a spherical community which benefits them all. It cannot be a multicellular organism because this communal gathering of organisms does not possess any intercellular systems. All multicellular organisms have intercellular systems. There is less in biology for evolutionists to conjecture regarding the claim that life evolved and became multicellular than there is in most other areas of evolution theory, with the exception of abiogenesis. There simply isn't anything in science upon which to claim the evolution of multicellularity. It is for this reason absurd. Question number 8. How did sex originate? Asexual reproduction gives up to twice as much reproductive success for the same resources as sexual reproduction. So how could the latter ever gain enough advantage to be selected? And how could mere physics and chemistry invent the complementary apparatuses needed at the same time, such as male and female organs? To which I add, natural selection should remove any organism from the gene pool if it developed a morphological difference which would require some other kind of morphological difference for reproduction. It is completely irrational to believe that an unsurpassable and an unsurpassable problem to be overcome by any scenario of evolution, no matter how complex or detailed. This illustrates the illogical and irrational nature of evolutionism, which contradicts itself in many ways. If an organism were to develop a structural change to its morphology which would require a corresponding structure for reproduction, natural selection would eliminate any and all examples of such organisms because of the impossible demand it would create for the organism's survival. Even more absurd would be the idea that somehow both male and female corresponding reproductive structures would evolve simultaneously. The idea is beyond lunacy. Furthermore, if we are to believe the Word of God, and God Himself, manifest as Jesus Christ, God has conclusively told us that sex did not evolve. The Bible states, in Genesis 1:27, "So God created man in His own image, in the image of God created him, him, male and female created He them." And Jesus Christ stated in Matthew 19:4, "And he answered and said unto them, Have ye not read that he which made them at the beginning made them male and female?" According to God Himself, these passages alone tell us that special creation is how all of life came into being, and that evolution is false. Not only this, but in Romans 1, the Bible actually provides a prophecy of the coming of evolution theory and a statement that is false, and science fully supports the Bible on this matter. Question number 9. Why are the expected countless millions of transitional fossils missing? Darwin noted on the problem, and it still remains. The evolutionary family trees and textbooks are based on imagination, not fossil evidence. Famous Harvard paleontologist and evolutionist Stephen Jay Gould wrote, quote, "The extreme rarity of transitional forms in the fossil record persists as a trade secret of paleontology," end quote. Other evolutionist fossil experts also admit to the problem. To which I add, the fossil record of the earth is evidence of a worldwide flood which covered the earth with deep sediments in which are trapped trillions of organisms. Examination of the strata of the earth reveals that the majority of strata possess grain size distribution and have highly distinct boundaries between them. If the long deposition of uniformitarianists were true, the strata could not have these characteristics. We should find instead the properties in the upper lithosphere, that's just the upper portion of the geologic column, would show gradation between the strata, and this should not have grain size distribution. Evolutionist scientists themselves admit that their theory is contradicted by the fossil record of life on the Earth. A great many of them have stated so in their own works. The reason they make these admissions is because if they were to state that the fossil record provides the transitional forms expected to exist because of evolution, they would look unprofessional and uninformed to their peers, and this would cause many raised eyebrows and the question of their worth as a questioning of their worth as a scientist. It is for them, unfortunately, necessary that they preach evolution while at the same time are obligated by their professional status to admit the truth about the fossil record of life, and this leaves them in the uncomfortable position of having to argue against themselves and dismiss commentary about their own admissions when questioned about them. To combat this problem, they typically resort to the excuses that the fossil record is incomplete, which is a great understatement, because erosion has washed away and destroyed many transitional forms. They also support the claim that the absence of transitional fossils in the fossil record is partly due to the fact that these forms have simply not been found yet, but that they are waiting for discovery. Yet, the Earth has been dug for fossils for over 150 years, and many millions of fossils have been recovered. If evolution were true, transitional forms would outnumber fully formed organisms by trillions to one. There should be no doubt from the fossil record that evolution is a fact. Evolutionist Mark Ridley, professor of zoology at Oxford, confesses, quote, "In any case, no real evolutionist, whether gradualist or punctuationist, uses the fossil record as any evidence in favor of the theory of evolution as opposed to special creation," end quote.